Hello everyone, my name is Luke, and in this video, we're going to take the popular k-means clustering algorithm and see how fast we can get it going. So I'm not going to go over too much detail about how the k-means clustering algorithm works. There's a lot of content already out there explaining how it is. So if you're unfamiliar, maybe go check out some of that first. So all the code I'm going to be going through is available in my PyTorch tutorial repo. There'll be a link in the description below, right? But in this video, we're just going to look at optimizing the k-means clustering algorithm. So how we're going to do that is by identifying some of the redundancy or redundant operations that we might be performing and sort of removing those or optimizing for those. So I've got a number of implementations, each one faster than the last. So this very first implementation that we're going to get into is what I'd call sort of a naive or explicit implementation of k-means clustering. This is something that I'd see students do if there was a sort of first time implementing an algorithm, where they sort of explicitly lay out step by step sort of how the algorithm works in their code. But it does lead to, you know, many nested for loops that do slow them down quite a bit. But we're going to see how we can really think about what we're doing in order to speed up things quite a lot and use some of the tools that may be at our disposal. So like I said, I'm not going to go into too much detail about how the k-means clustering algorithm works, but we're going to focus on the parts that are sort of important to us. Like you can see this first part here where we're doing our cluster assignments. You know, naively, you might loop through every single data point, you know, find the distance between that data point, loop through every mean, and to find the distance between that data point and every mean. And then once you've done that, find which of those cluster means this data point is the closest to, log all that. Then once you've done that, loop through all the means and then update those, right, to get the new cluster means. So we're going to do this using, we're going to do k-means clustering on the nNIST dataset. So it's a dataset of numbers, if you're unfamiliar. And we're going to use 10 means. I'm going to go for 100 iterations. So we're going to perform 100 iterations. And hopefully we'll get, you know, one cluster mean, one cluster per digit. We probably won't though. We're not going to use k-means++. We're just going to randomly initialize those means at the start. So let's run this code and see if we can get a, see how fast it is, and we'll use that as our sort of baseline. So if this is the sort of code you write, don't worry too much. We'll see how you can improve this and how you can think about optimizing these sorts of problems. So I won't make you wait. I'll pause the video and get back to when we're done. All right, so 100 iterations are done, and you can see it took 92.66 seconds. So let's have a look at our means. You can see we've got our blurry means. Not quite one per, you know, digit, but close enough. If we change to k-means++, change the initialization, get better. But importantly, you can see it took quite a lot of time, 92 seconds for our 100 iterations. Now, writing your code out like this can be beneficial if this is the sort of first time you've tried to implement a particular algorithm. Laying it out like this can make it a bit more intuitive and seeing what the algorithm is actually doing. But once you've done that, of course, you might want to try to optimize it to speed it up. So how we're going to do that is use broadcasting, right? And we'll get to that in a moment. But, you know, let's first look at what we can actually, you know, update and how we can sort of clean this up a bit. The first point is that this cluster assignment step here, the calculation of the distance between each data point and each mean is independent from each other, right? And finding which mean each data point is associated with, all that is independent. So that what that means is that, you know, the value for one data point is not dependent on what value we get for another data point. So we can perform all those operations in a single step, right? We don't need to use nested for loops. Right. Similar, the means, when we update the means, when we sort of take the average over all the data points associated with a particular cluster to get our new mean, each one of those mean updates we do is independent from all the others. What that means is that we can also condense this and perform that mean update step in a single operation all at once. And like I said, we're going to use broadcasting for that. So we're using NumPy in Python, and we're going to use NumPy broadcasting. So broadcasting is in a lot of libraries, but it is also in NumPy. If you're unfamiliar with broadcasting, I'm not going to go into it here, but I do have a section in my NumPy tutorial that is in the Python basics section 0 here that goes over what broadcasting is and gives you a little example. So let's move on to the broadcasting solution for our k-means clustering. Again, we're using mnist and we're going to do clustering, just randomly initializing our means again. So you can see our new k-means clustering algorithm. We have quite a lot less code, quite a lot fewer lines. You could probably condense this even further if you wanted to, but I've laid it out to make it a bit clearer. So the first step, we're going to calculate the difference between every data point and every mean in a single step using broadcasting, because they're all independent. And how we do that is we need to expand each of the matrices for our mean and our data points. So we get an empty dimension. So when we perform the broadcasting, we get that repeating or that stretching over those dimensions. What we'll be left with after we do that is a big three-dimensional tensor. So I can just run that here and we'll have a look at the shape. Get a big three-dimensional tensor or array, 10,000 by 10 by 784. So we've got 10,000 data points. For every data point, we have a vector that is the difference between that data point and the mean. So for every data point and every mean, we have a difference vector or a difference vector. To get to the actual distance, all we're gonna do is use the mean squared error. So all that requires us to do is to square all the values in place operation and then take the average over that final dimension, which is the sort of size of the data points. What we get from that is 10,000 by 10. So for every single data point, we have a single value for every mean, and that is the mean squared difference or mean squared error for that data point and that particular mean. Now to actually do the assignment, all we need to do is get the argmin. So take the argmin over that second dimension. So we're gonna go through every value and find the minimum one and return the actual index. So now what we're left with is a single vector, a single array of indices, one per data point. So we've got 10,000 for each data point. What we've got is the index of the mean that this data point is closest to. So we've done our cluster assignments in only three lines of code. You can condense that to probably two or even less if you wanted to. But now we've done that, we need to actually do the main point, which is the update of our means. So how are we going to do that? Well, we're going to use this index of means, these indices we've calculated, and we're going to do a few more tricks, right? We're not going to loop over this index of means and do it that way. We're going to use an identity matrix and some clever indexing to actually update the means. So if you're not familiar, an identity matrix is just a matrix of zeros with ones along the diagonal here, right? And what we're going to do is we're going to construct this one hot coded matrix by indexing that identity matrix with the index of means. So just make sure I've got that here. And then we're going to transpose it. So I'll go through why in a second. So what we're left with is this A matrix. So if we don't transpose it, just to make it a bit clearer, we've got for every single data point, a vector size 10. And what that vector is, let's grab the first one for the first data point, is a one hot coded vector. That is a vector of all zeros, but a single one in one location. And that location will be the index of the mean this data point was assigned to. So you can see we've got a big matrix where every row is a single vector with a single one in the location of the index of the mean that data point was assigned to. And then we're going to transpose it. And what we should have now is, right, we've just transposed it, rotated it, is for every single mean, we've got a big long vector with ones in the location corresponding to the data point that was assigned to this mean, right? Be mostly zeros, but a one in the location saying, hey, this data point here was assigned to this mean. So one row per data point. So how are we going to use this to update our means? Well, if we take this transposed and multiply it by the original data set, we remember our original data set is shape 10,000 by 784 and A is 10 by 10,000, right? What we get as a result is a big 10 by 784. What does this represent? Well, this represents For every mean, we have a vector, same size as our data, each data point, but this vector is the sum of every data point that has been assigned to that mean, the sum. So that's what we get by multiplying this sort of binary matrix by our original data set. So for every mean, we've got the sum of every data point that was assigned to that mean, but we don't want the sum, we want the average, we want the mean. So we need to divide this by the total number of counts, or the total number of data points that was assigned to that mean. So how do we do that? Well, we can again just use A, right? And if we sum over that second dimension, so reminder, this was 10 by 10,000, right? For each mean, we have a vector with ones in the location of the data point that was assigned to it. If we just sum that up, what we'll get is the total number of counts, the total number of data points that was assigned to each mean, right? So we just need to divide our sum matrix by this counts matrix, and we'll get, right, the mean, right? And that is our cluster center update. To do that, you need to expand to make sure that this is a 2D matrix again, so we can do a broadcast divide, not actually a broadcast divide, but so we can do a proper divide. And that is our update. So let's run this now and see how much faster it is. So again, I'll pause the recording and get back when it's done. Right, so there we go. We've done our 100 iterations in 32.49 seconds. So if we compare that to our baseline, 92.66 seconds, and we'll just quickly divide that by our 32.49 seconds. You can see it's about three times faster. So 2.8 times faster. So I promised a lot faster, but hopefully you can see that this code is much cleaner. But we can't really get any faster if we're just using NumPy like this, because I'm using a single CPU. Even though we're using broadcasting, each of the actual operations, the calculations, still needs to be performed sequentially, right? Because we're using a CPU, performs it sequentially. The speed up we've gotten here is basically by removing a lot of the redundancy, the logging, and some of the other operations that we're doing, the ifs, right? We've removed all that redundancy, and so we've got a almost three times speed up by doing it that way. However, we can now utilize the fact that we've got it in this form with broadcasting to use some more of the tools that might be at our disposal. As I said, the calculation of the cluster assignments and the mean updates, right? All those calculations we're doing, they're all independent of each other. And so they can literally be performed at the same time. However, we'll need to move on to slightly different hardware, and that is going from a CPU to a GPU, right? The main benefit of a GPU is that it can perform a large number of operations at the same time, a large number of independent operations at the same time. So that's what we'll look at now. And to do that, we're going to move on to PyTorch. And we're going to utilize PyTorch's tensors and its CUDA ability as well. We don't need to use PyTorch. PyTorch is a whole deep learning framework. If you're unfamiliar, again, I have a PyTorch tutorial series as well as a YouTube playlist. However, if you're not really going to go into deep learning, you can use something like QPy, which is basically like a NumPy drop-in replacement that is CUDA GPU enabled. I'm not going to go into how you can use this in this video. If you're interested, let me know and maybe I can do a short video on using QPy. But again, with that, we can optimize even further by changing hardware to really get this a lot faster. But for now, I'm going to go switch into PyTorch. You don't really need to know much about PyTorch to understand what's going on here. A lot of the operations I'm performing are identical, even right by name, by function call, to NumPy. So you can see the code is, I've laid it out pretty much exactly the same, right? But we're going to see how much faster we can get it going by using the GPU. Firstly, though, I'm going to use PyTorch just on a CPU because PyTorch is optimized quite a lot for matrix operations because there's a lot of that in deep learning. It is actually still a bit faster than the NumPy implementation, even though we're sort of doing exactly the same number of steps and the same function calls. So you can see, I don't have to pause the video. It's almost done already. Only took 14 seconds to do our 100 iterations as compared to 32 seconds. So about twice as fast again. So we're almost four or five times faster than that initial implementation. Just by using PyTorch, we're still on CPU. We just switched to PyTorch now. You can see we've got our means again. But that's not what you're here for. Let's see how much faster it goes once we swap from our CPU to using a GPU. So let's run this again in PyTorch with a GPU. So restart run all, and we're done. All right, if you blink, you'll miss it. 100 iterations only took 0.73. So that really hopefully clearly highlights how much we were waiting on the fact that we were performing each of those operations sequentially when they could have all been performed at the same time, right? So we've removed a lot of the for loops. We have to keep the outer for loop, right? The means from one step depend on the means from the previous step, so they're not independent. So we have to keep that outer loop. We've removed all those loops, but because we were performing the actual calculations, or our CPU was performing the calculations sequentially, that was still a bottleneck when we could have been performing them literally in parallel with something like a GPU. You can see we've now got 0.3 seconds for the entire 100 iterations. But what if I told you this was actually a lot faster than it looks? PyTorch is actually has a few initialization steps when you're performing calculations, if you're just running the code for the first time. And this first matrix multiplication step is actually a lot slower than all of the other, you know, sequential, the next ones, right? Because it has to do, I won't go into too much detail, it does a bit of initialization with the buffers. And so that first matrix multiplication we're doing here is quite a lot slower than the next ones. So if we just do a quick sort of no-op, multiplying the identity matrix, which again, I've actually initialized outside of this loop because it's the same every time. If we multiply that by the means, this is kind of like a no-op. We'll do that initialization outside of this for loop and see how fast it really is. So let's run this again. And there we go, 0.02 seconds. So pretty much all of the time that it took to run this loop was actually in that initialization setup. So what that means is that we could have done 100 iterations, or we could have done 1,000 or 10,000 iterations, and we wouldn't have actually added that much time to the total time it took, because each iteration was actually 0.00002 seconds long compared to 0.32 or 0.9, almost a second. So if we take this value from our initial run, from our basic solution, and we divide that by our optimized one, let's see how much faster we actually got it running. There we go, 4,633 times faster. Now I know we've swapped hardware, so you might think that's cheating, but it just hopefully clearly highlights, if you've got this sort of redundancy, or you've got parallelization or independent operations in your code, you can greatly improve performance by swapping to a GPU. Like I said, if you want to stick with NumPy, you can use something like QPy. However, if you are interested in using PyTorch and getting into deep learning, like I said, I have a whole PyTorch tutorial series where I start from Python basics, and I'm adding more and more content all the time. And I have a whole YouTube tutorial series as well, where I go through that code and explain it. So hopefully you got something out of that, or is at least interesting. If you liked it, please like the video and subscribe if you are interested in more. Like I said, go check out that PyTorch tutorial series if you're interested, and I'll catch you in the next one. See ya.